Good evening, everybody. We'll just wait for everyone to join us. Good evening, folks. Just watching lots of people coming in to join the webinar. We'll just wait for another few seconds. Let everyone come in. Evening, everybody. Okay, I think we've just about got everyone, a few people still joining, but I think we will kick off. So good evening and welcome to the latest installment of our Naturetrek Winter Roadshow. This evening, we are taking you to the fabulous USA. I'm delighted to be joined by a quartet of fabulous tour leaders this evening. So I'm from the office. My name is Kerry Porteous. I'm one of the operations managers, but I'm on my own from the office this evening. And I've got Matthew Kappa, who's up in Chesterfield. I've got Brian Small over in Southwold in Suffolk, and Adam, Dudley and Jane Dixon, who are in near lovely York. So they're all joining this evening to tell about Florida, about Arizona, Southern California, Texas, the Dakotas, and Cape May. So we've got a fantastic range of destinations to take you to this evening. We've made it to the end of January. Well done, everybody. No one really knew what January was going to be like. When we think back to December, it could have gone either way, really. And in the travel industry, we were feeling quite nervous when Omicron was on the rise. But it's been all right. We've done quite well. We've been sending some people on some lovely tours. We've had groups off to the Gambia, to Sri Lanka, to Spain, Romania, Bulgaria, all over the place. Matthew's off to Florida next week. So we've been out traveling again and we've been really, really pleased about it. It's been great to be back doing what we love doing, sending people on fabulous wildlife holidays, hearing about their adventures, seeing their feedback when they get back. So more of the same for the rest of the year, please. As always, we are here to answer any questions you might have. So there's the chat box and the question answer box that you can use during the evening. If you pop your questions in the Q&A, that helps us keep track of them. We might type some answers as we go during the evening, but we'll also wrap up lots of those at the end. So just pop them in as we go and we'll pick them up at 9:05 once Brian's finished talking about Cape May. So that's about it for me. I will stop speaking and I'm going to hand over to Matthew, who's going to kick off taking us to sunny Florida. Over to you, Matthew.
Super. Thanks very much, Kerry. Evening, everybody. It's real pleasure to be with you. And as Kerry says, my name is Matthew Kappa. I'm a Naturetrek tour leader. I do this in my spare time. So my day job is with Lincolnshire Wildlife Trust. So I'm their head of public engagement and communications. I've been with Naturetrek for a few years now, and Florida is one of the tours that I do regularly. So as you can see here, we're going to be talking about the Sunshine State. This is a fantastic winter birding destination. And as Kerry said, we are literally heading out in a week's time. So this time next week, I'll be down at Heathrow, which is really, really exciting to be back. We missed last year for obvious reasons. So to be getting back to Florida is really, really exciting. So I think probably most of you know where Florida is, but here we are. We're down in the southeast of the United States. It's the southernmost point of the US. And as you can see, we've got the Gulf of Mexico on one side of us. We've got the Atlantic on the other. So it has an incredibly long coastline, Florida. And if you're in Florida, you're no more than 60 miles from the sea, wherever you are. The weather, as we say, Sunshine State. So we've got 300 days of sunshine here in Florida every year. It is the place where they invented suntan lotion. And in February, when we're out here, we're going to be talking sort of mid 20s. It's the drier time of the year, so we won't really be getting any rain, maybe the odd rainy day, the odd shower, but really it should be largely dry, which is really, really good. And if we zoom in just a little bit more, you can see the itinerary that we're doing here. This is a 10-day tour of Florida. It's a bird watching focused trip. We literally crisscross the state, as you can see. We fly into Orlando and back out from Miami. And we take in a number of the best Florida birding sites along the way. And that gives us a nice variety of habitats as well. So the wildlife changes regularly as the trip progresses. We tend to stay in sort of chain hotels. So things like Marriott's, Comfort Suites and Inns, those kind of places. So they're well appointed, nice, comfortable hotels. And what we've done is we've set an itinerary where each place that we go to, we stay for 2 nights. So rather than just turn up and then move on, it gives you a little bit of time to settle in and stay a couple of nights. And that's quite good. So although we're covering lots of ground, there's a nice balance there as well, but they're not moving all the time, which is good. And it's fair to say that Florida is a photographer's dream. This is a photo that I took a few years back, grey plover with the sunset behind it on a beach in Florida. And the light levels here, as you can see, Florida is a great place if you want to take photos or get into wildlife photography, because you get really good shutter speeds with the light levels. The birds are plentiful. They're everywhere. They're tame. They tend to stand still quite a lot with the herons and egrets. So it's a really good place if you want to get into your wildlife photography. And it's a really nice mix of bird species that we get as well. So going in February, at that time of year, you've got some of the American birds that normally would migrate south. They're still in Florida at the south there. So you still get some of those summer birds that you would think of elsewhere are still around. Some of the exotics from further south, the frigate birds, things like that. So it's a really nice blend of things to give you a good introduction to American birds. And the American setup for birding is really, really good as well. So they have some really good facilities at their reserves, lots of boardwalks. The Americans love a wildlife drive. So there's lots of options to view, lots of well laid out reserves. And it just means that we can spend time either walking through the habitats or driving along some of these places and just stopping periodically whenever we see there's something good to look at. We tend to use we've switched this year to a big 12-seater minibus. So there's good height, good visibility as we're driving along. So it works really, really well as a birding tour. And this is sort of just characteristic if you're going to these wetland reserves. There are lots of herons and egrets. We might get 15 species of heron or egret and stork and things like that during a day. Lots of wildfowl like these blue-winged teal, lots of waders. There's Wilson snipe on here. The drive we do at Sanibel Island at J-Ending Darling, we get things like roseate spoonbill here, reddish egret in the middle, tri-coloured heron, lots and lots of stuff to see all the time. Which is part of the attraction for Florida, really. And we visit a site called Merritt Island. This is one of the iconic US birding sites. Cape Canaveral, which is NASA's space center. When they purchased the land, what they didn't need, they turned into a big wildlife refuge. So we drive around bird watching during the day with a backdrop of rocket launch pads. And one of the species that we get here is Florida scrub jay, which is the one that you can see on the screen. And this is Florida's only endemic bird. So it's a good one to get. These are very tame. Sometimes they'll perch on people's heads. And it means that they also are very easy to photograph. And you tend to see several when you see one, because these are birds that go around in family parties. So the young birds will help the parents to raise chicks, as when they're 1 year old birds, they'll help raise the next year's brood. So they're quite a nice species. And there's a long term study here at Merritt Island. You can see this bird here that I photographed is color ringed. And it's not all birds. We see a good variety of other wildlife as well. Sometimes we find these out during the day. This is a nine-banded armadillo. Especially if it's been rainy, they're often, with the ground being soft, they'll go out during the day. These have got really, really poor eyesight, so they're often oblivious to the presence of people. So you often find yourself backing off from these. If they just keep coming towards you, they just don't know you're there. This one, 2 years ago, actually walked over somebody's foot. And another one of the really good birds that we see in Florida, this, when you talk to clients beforehand, they often tell you this is on their high on their wanted list, really. And a lot of the reserves that we go to, they have bird feeding stations outside the visitor centres, and they attract this bird, which is a painted bunting. So really, if you were to give a kid a blank bird and ask them to paint it, they would literally do this. So I think it's really aptly named. Really, really stunning. The males, the females are more of an olivey green, but the males are really, really stunning. And we normally get them at two or three sites when we're on this tour. And one of our days, we spend out in the countryside, south of Kissimmee. And it's kind of open countryside. There's small areas of woodland, large ranches, lots of cattle. And this sort of area, one of the real characteristic birds is the sandhill crane. And we can get flocks that can be hundreds strong going over during the day. And the bugling call of the cranes is such an evocative backdrop to this day. Call of cranes is one of my favourite bird sounds. So it's really, really nice to get those on this particular bit of the tour. And the farmland's also home to things like killdeer, American kestrel. We should get things like wild turkey. We get eastern meadowlark, which is the one here on the right, this lovely yellow breast with black dot here. Really, really nice fluty song, which you can often hear as you're birding in this area. And the one on the left here, that's a crested caracara. And this is the best area in the state that we visit to look for these. So we put a bit of time in. There's a particular road we drive down and we just stop and scan. And these often perch up quite low by the side of the road. So we often get really close views like this one here. These are quite a stunning bird of prey. And eventually on this particular day, we arrive at a place called Joe Overstreet Landing, which is actually on Lake Kissimmee itself. And there's a boardwalk here and a little viewing area, as you can see. And it's excellent for birds. We normally stop and have a bit of a picnic lunch here. And one of the species that you can almost guarantee off the end of this boardwalk is this particular species. This is a snail kite. Now, this is an endangered bird in Florida. There's only probably about 400 pairs breeding. These are endangered really because they're very restricted to one particular type of food. So these eat apple snails. This is a snail that's probably as big or slightly bigger than your fist. And so these fly over the aquatic vegetation and basically pluck the snails off the vegetation, and then they'll take them to a perch. And they've actually evolved a curved beak, so they can actually slide the beak into the snail shell and pull out the snail from within. So they're quite a nice one to get. You can see a really nice slate grey colour and a nice white rump, which is, again, very distinctive to be able to see those and pick them out. And Joe Overstreet is one of our best spots for bald eagle as well. We see these quite regularly throughout the tour, but there's a couple of bald eagle nests at this particular location. So sometimes if they're busy nesting, we get the real privilege of being able to set the scope up actually on the nest and watching the adults feeding the chicks, which is superb and something that the clients always are really, really wowed by. I mean, I think any eagle experience is really nice, but to see one actually feeding the chicks is a bit of a wow. And if we move on down to the West Palm Beach area, home to a certain Donald Trump, but also home to a couple of superb little wetlands One called Green K, and another one, slightly odd name, called Wakadahatchee. These have got circular boardwalks. So we spend a bit of time just wandering along the boardwalk, stopping periodically and looking. And actually, to be fair, it's been so hard to drag people away from this particular area that we've added another night to the itinerary to allow people to just enjoy this area a little bit more leisurely, which is good. And one of the things that we see here and we see regularly is alligator. 2 million alligators in Florida. So we get those a lot, and you can get some really, really big alligators at times. Mostly if you're on the boardwalk, we view them and watch from a safe distance. Occasionally you might get one on a path and we have to give them a little bit of a wide berth, show them a little bit of respect. But they're quite cool to see. We do like seeing alligators regularly. There's a woodstock colony at Wakadahatchee. These are the ones on the left. And again, you're walking through 3 or 4 meters away from the birds on the nest. So that's quite nice. It's also probably one of the best sites in the state for American bittern. They're a wintering bird down here in Florida. And again, they can be really close. We've nearly missed them before because they've literally been underneath the boardwalk. The one here on the right was photographed just with a phone. It was that close. You didn't, you know, if you had a big lens, you just wouldn't have got it in the whole frame. So again, it's just illustrative of how tame the birds are in Florida, really. And over on the west of the state, we stay in a place called Fort Myers, which is close to Sanibel Island. Sanibel Island is a wonderful little barrier island with amazing sandy beaches on the Gulf Coast. One of my favourite places in the world, let alone in Florida, to be fair. My in-laws used to have a house in Fort Myers, so I used to go and stay there regularly, which is how I was introduced to Florida, really. And we do a wildlife drive on Sanibel, but we also, I always make sure that we spend a little bit of time at the end of the day just giving people a chance to wander along the beach, maybe pick up a few shells, look at a few birds, could be an osprey fishing offshore or some pelicans. Often there's dolphins just offshore here. And it's just a nice way to give people a little bit of time to relax, have a little bit of a mooch. And we always then just sit and watch the sun just sink into the Gulf of Mexico. It's one of the special things about the Florida Gulf Coast. And then we head off for the evening for somewhere to eat. So it's a nice way to end that particular day. This is another one of our target birds. This is a burrowing owl, very similar to our little owl, but these things nest in little burrows on the ground. And Cape Coral, which is near to Fort Myers, this has got the largest density of burrowing owls anywhere in the state. Largely in artificial burrows. So basically they've sunk big kind of tubes into the ground and made these little artificial burrow areas. And the birds have taken to those really well. So what we tend to do is just drive around the neighborhoods. It's in residential area and just look for the artificial burrows. And then you just see, is there a bird at home sitting out in the open? No, just move on to the next. And when there is, we stop, get out, have a little bit of a look. And you can get really nice and close, as you can see here. This is a photo taken about 4 years ago, this one. If both birds are out, you can often get really nice views and see the difference as well. The males are paler than the females because they sit outside more during the day. Females tend to sit and incubate eggs and things. So the males get bleached by the sun. So they're always paler than the females. This is where I took that photo earlier of the grey plover with the sunset. This is a place called Bunch Beach. It's a little hidden gem. Not many birders go. Quite a few people go and use the beach. So we tend to go early in the day here. But this is a really nice place to get a really good selection of wading birds. So piping plover here on the left, top left, leaf sandpipers here in the bottom, willet up here on the top right. But we also get Wilson's plover, snowy plover. There's normally dowitchers, leased sandpiper, I've mentioned western sandpiper. There's often great northern diver offshore, red-breasted mergansers. So it's a good place to start the day, this, with a nice selection of wading birds. And this area is also good because it's got a place called the Lee County Manatee Park. Now, this is where we go, unsurprisingly, to look for our manatees. We have a few sites that we hope to get them, but this is our banker site for manatee. And this is actually the water outlet from an electricity power station. So manatees are quite sensitive to water temperature. So if the water temperature goes below 68 degrees, they head off south to warmer water. But because you've got the warm water coming out of the power station here, it means that these manatees. These manatees can basically hang out in the warm water coming out of the power station, head out into the Gulf to the cooler water to feed, come back and warm up again. So it means that they can spend the winter here, whereas they might not ordinarily be able to. So that means that we go there. We can expect to see good numbers. we saw over 20 2 years ago when we were there, which is really quite special. And you can see they're just fantastic, really, really strange animals, these. And another one of our famous reserves in Florida is Corkscrew Swamp Sanctuary. This is a National Audubon Society reserve, which is their kind of RSPB equivalent. Again, this is another different habitat entirely. So huge sort of tall cypress trees with these buttress roots in this big swamp. And we just spend a morning walking along the boardwalk here. Lots to see, lots of warblers, flycatchers, woodpeckers, things like this. Red-shouldered hawk here on the left, we get quite a few there. Barred owl is quite common here. You often hear them calling, but sometimes they can just be sat out during the day like this one. We keep an eye out for those as well. We get limpkin here, which is a really weird, nice prehistoric bird with a really wailing call. Excuse me. And then we also then head down to the south of the state to finish off in the Everglades. So you couldn't really go to Florida and not go to the Everglades. It's one of the most famous wetlands on Earth. And we birdwatch the wetlands, and we also birdwatch these little wooded areas called hammocks, which you can see here. And we look for things like this, which is a scissor-tailed flycatcher, fantastic tail streamers on this. And we also birdwatch some of the wetlands. This is the Anhinga Trail. The water here is crystal clear, so you can actually get a real view down into just the layers of life, the fish, the anhingas catching fish underwater, the turtles swimming. It's just a magical place. The wetland water here is just crystal clear. We also park carefully at the Anhinga Trail. I always park close to the visitor center because if you park further away, you're liable to have a little bit of vandalism. This is a black vulture. So we always make sure we're out of the way of these things. It's quite fun to watch them doing it to somebody else's car, but not when it's your own. And then we head down to Flamingo, down at the bottom of the Everglades. This is the southernmost point of the mainland US. Ospreys here are just 10 a penny. We tend to view them as, you know, really endangered special birds that have to be kept at a distance. And you can literally just walk past the nest here at the marina. And one of the things we look for here is crocodile. So this is the only place in the world where you get alligator and crocodile together. 2 million alligators, only 1,500 crocodiles, so much harder to see, but we haven't failed yet. And then our last day, we just spend it relatively relaxed in the Miami area. There's no real wetlands, so we tend to birdwatch some of the downtown areas. And the real characteristic birds of this area are actually more exotic species. So there's lots of introduced and escaped species over the years that have established. So things like common miner here on the left. There's over 70 different species of parrot. This is a mitred parakeet on the right. And so we go to various places, can be residential areas, malls, and we're looking for a whole wide range of different things. lizard species as well. This is a red-headed agama on the left, should be in West Africa. Iguanas are everywhere. Some of them are huge. So we look for those as well. And then we tend to go to somewhere for just a bit of a relaxed lunch on the last day, somewhere like Matheson Hammock State Park here, sit around, have a bit of a relax, and just chance to catch up again on some of the warblers and vireos, maybe things like this yellow-throated warbler on the left or yellow-rumped on the right. And we see 10, 12 maybe species of warbler during the week, so it's a nice introduction to the warblers, although Brian later will probably be wowing you with a whole wider selection, I'm sure. But we get a few down in Florida at that time of year, which is nice. And then it's time basically to drive back to the airport, back to Miami airport, and hand back the keys to the hire vehicle, and we fly back to the UK. So that's it. That's a very, very quick, in 20 minutes, romp around Florida, a fraction of the 150 to 160 species of bird that we would probably hope to get, along with all of that supporting cast of the alligators and dolphins and manatees. Feel free to ask any questions in the chat or later, but that's it from me. Hopefully it's whetted your appetite for a trip to Florida. As I say, I'm off in a week, but if you want to join us next February, you would be more than welcome. Having had two storms over the weekend, it's a very, very nice thing to escape the British weather. But that's it from me. And I will happily hand you over to Adam, who's going to give us our next presentation.
Great. I'm just going to share my screen. Thank you very much, Matthew. Hopefully everybody can see my screen here. And I'm going to take you completely...
Adam, we can see your screen. We can't see you. I'm not sure that's intentional or not.
Ah, I can't see me. Okay. give me a second.
There you go. We've got you back.
Can you see me okay?
Yeah.
Great. Okay. I'm going to take you to completely the opposite side of America and talk to you about the wildlife of California and Arizona and try and cover each in about 10 minutes. So it's going to be a whistle-stop tour through what I think are two of the most amazing places in America. Starting in Southern California, the tour we run here goes in May, and it visits some of the most diverse scenery and iconic national parks in America. Down here, there's lots of open space, very approachable wildlife, incredible landscapes, and it's home to, you know, an incredible diversity of birds and mammals, lots of endemic species, like the Joshua trees you can see on this opening slide here, the endemic species of red-shouldered hawk on the left and the Rocky Mountain bighorn sheep on the right. excuse me. So this tour is a unique exploration, a traverse, if you like, across the bottom of California, starting in Los Angeles and ending in Las Vegas, and covering all aspects of Southern California and the journey. We start in Los Angeles and head out to the Channel Islands National Park to the west, a boat trip across amazing waters where we get cetaceans and seals and lots of seabirds. And to explore these islands that have lots of endemic species because they've been isolated for over 30,000 years. More about that in a second. We then work our way down the coast through very built up areas around Los Angeles and down to San Diego, where the tropical palm tree forests and lots of shorebird habitat, coastal scrub, oak forest, woodlands with their attendant species of birds, mammals and butterflies. before then, we start to work our way inland along the Mexican border over a big mountain range called the Laguna Mountains, where we stop at the Pacific Crest Trail and hike a bit of the Pacific Crest Trail for a morning, right when we're transitioning across from the coastal influence to the more desert influence of inland California. And we enter the Colorado Desert there with its incredible cacti and desert adapted species, such as the teddy bear choya, which is up on the top left there, taken Anza Borrego Desert State Park, which is just north of the Salton Sea that you can see on the map there. Salton Sea is one of my favorite places in America. It's a fantastic bird migration location. It's below sea level. Lots and lots of shorebirds and pelicans and grebes and things like that there as well. And from there, we actually head to some of the most iconic parks in America, Joshua Tree National Park. We leave the Colorado Desert and head into the Mojave Desert, where we go to Mojave National Preserve, into Death Valley National Park, where we go to the lowest point in the US, Badwater Basin. You can see there, 282 feet below sea level, a big salt lake in the middle of Death Valley. Before we then head out into Nevada and to a sky island, which is a very small mountain range protruding out of the desert, where we go up to a completely different habitat, 10,000 feet above sea level. And this sky island is fantastic for very unique wildlife that is only found on that mountain. And so that's a very quick review of a 2-week tour through the best of diversity in Southern California. So with that, let me just go on to some of the species that we might see during our trip, starting with the birds. Obviously, as I said, we start with a boat trip where we get seabirds such as this black-vented shearwater, very common, very commonly seen from the boat, along with lots of phalaropes and skuas and terns and gulls and those types of things. It's also cetaceans seen pretty commonly on that trip too. And once we get to the islands, there's about 20,000 species all told of endemic plants, insects, birds, mammals, et cetera, on those islands. Matthew showed you the Florida scrub jay. This is their equivalent on the very far west, the island scrub jay, which is only found on two of those islands, very rare. And they're also ringed and population monitored. So we'll do our best to find those. Once we've left the islands, we spend some time in the coastal area of California, where the oak forests are particularly lovely. And they're home to species like this Nuttall's woodpecker here on the bottom left. It's a bit like our lesser spotted woodpecker, I suppose. Similar type of call, but just a stunning bird. And we have a lot of time looking at water birds along the coast, but also inland, as I said, at the Salton Sea. Birds like this Clark's grebe, very similar to the western grebe, which is also very common in those areas. Now, migration will be in full spring, when we at full pelt when we go in spring, and lots of shorebirds is migrating through. We could see over 20, maybe even 25 species of shorebirds, from the rocky coast specialists to birds like this western sandpiper. Of course, they're all in their amazing breeding finery. They're not in their drab winter plumage. My wife Jane, who's talking in a minute, says they wear their tuxedos. They look really posh and smart, rather than their jeans, as they're just slouching around. So they're a fantastic part of the tour. Also flycatchers like this Hammond's flycatcher are moving through. Warblers, bottom left here, this is a Virginia's warbler, which reaches its westernmost breeding on Mount Charleston, just outside of Las Vegas, and we'll do our best to find those at high altitude. And obviously lots of desert special birds like this black-throated sparrow here. It's a very common, regularly seen species in all of the deserts in the southwest of the US, but one of my personal favorite birds of this trip. But this tour is a wildlife tour, in addition to the probably over 200 species of birds we'll get on that trip. It's excellent for mammals as well, from coastal species I've mentioned already, cetaceans, but pinnipeds like the California sea lion at the top right of the screen here is particularly common. You know, we're visiting built up areas too around San Diego and Las Vegas, where raccoons are pretty common. Obviously they're also throughout this habitat, but we stand a chance of seeing those. Once we get into the deserts proper, actually we start to run into things like coyotes that you can see in the middle of the screen there. They are in the cities as well, but I like seeing them out in their natural habitat in the desert. Black-tailed jackrabbit at the bottom there is a relative of our hare. They're also found from the coast into the deserts. Very, very large rabbit, lovely to see. And so from from large coyotes all the way to really, really small endemic chipmunks like this Palmer's chipmunk, which is only found on Mount Charleston outside of Vegas. And we do a lovely walk through a fantastic valley to look for those little guys that are just beautiful. So butterflies are also fantastic in California. Lots of different butterflies that we might see. I'm particularly partial to hair streaks myself. The top right butterfly here, great purple hair streak. It's one of my favorites. It's got the false head, if you like, of its tail, where those two antennae pretend to be its head. So if a predator attacks it, it can just keep living fine. On the left, bear's metal mark. I love metal marks actually as well, but for a different reason, because they don't really move very much. And so you can get great pictures up close. They favor particular plants they like. And so I really like metal marks for that reason. Bottom left, Western giant swallowtails, the biggest butterfly in North America. So a good chance of seeing those. They're only identified as a separate species in 2014, so a relatively recent split. And then, of course, the Western monarch, which this year now is having the best year for many, many, many seasons. In fact, there's over, from the counts that we've been seeing on the West Coast now, there's over 100-fold higher population this year than there was last year, which is just fantastic to see them bouncing back, probably because of the wonderful rains that have been happening in the Southwest, both in monsoon last year, but also in the winter. So that's really good news. And we should see monarchs, Western monarchs, which are the population west of the Sierra Nevada mountains in California on this trip. No discussion of going to some of the deserts in the US could be complete without reptiles. And there's a lot of reptiles in California, from fantastic zebra-tailed lizard in the top left there, through different types of snakes like gopher snake, bottom left, which predate on other snakes like rattlesnakes. The one in the middle there is a Pacific rattlesnake. There are 7 species in California, but Pacific is one of the commonest, and we'll do our best to try and find those. And then one of my favorite lizards, the bottom right there, southern alligator lizard. It's quite a big lizard, actually, very charismatic, I think. Like looking at those. And then amphibians like the Baja California tree frog. This is what's given us our societal thought of what frogs sound like, which is rebbit. These are the frogs that give that call. And we've adopted that as our call of frogs because they're found near Hollywood. And so their call has been used in many a film score over the years. And they're actually very, very small, quite hard to find. But we've got some good sites for those. So they should be good to see. So I don't know what's going on with my slides here. There are lots of other specialities that I'd like to talk about, but we don't really have time on this whistle stop tour, but wren tit on the top left there, that's a coastal specialist, beautiful charismatic bird. We also see hummingbirds. There's quite a few hummingbirds in California. This is an Allen's hummingbird. The ones down in the Southwest, they don't migrate, they're there all year. So that's great to see. And endemic birds like California thrasher, bottom right, California towhee, pretty common. And then this beautiful island fox. It's really small, it's about the size of our cat. Very rare, only found on the islands, as I said earlier, and they're radio collared. So the scientists who study them know where they are at all times, but these guys are absolutely beautiful, and we'll do our best to find those when we go to the islands. So please come to California with us. Our next tour is in May this year. We might even see the border wall, like you can see right there, as we travel along between California and Mexico towards Arizona, which is the next destination that I'd like to talk about. A completely different set of wildlife. In a fabulous state, a state that Jane and I call home. Our home is there, our house is there, and in Tucson. And Arizona is one of the best states in America for birds, for reptiles and butterflies. And particularly things like this Rivoli's hummingbird on the left, one of up to 13 or 14 species of hummingbirds that we may see in Arizona. the Western Diamondback rattlesnake on the bottom of the picture there. Fantastic snake, excuse me. One of the commonest snakes in Arizona, actually, that we see very regularly. And then Arizona State butterfly there, two-tailed swallowtail, really big, nice butterfly. Just a few of the iconic species that we might see on our trip around Arizona. So actually, I'd like to do a quick thanks to David Attenborough and his discussion last night in Green Planet of the Sonoran Desert and his shameless advertising for this tour. I don't actually need to give this presentation, I don't think, given what he was talking about. But nevertheless, our tours in Arizona focus on the Sonoran Desert primarily. We fly into Phoenix, the top of the map there, and we spend most of our time exploring right along the Mexico border, the sky islands of this desert. And you can see those marked in green on this map. These are the high mountains that are above the flat desert, with up to 7,000 or 8,000 feet difference in elevation between those two habitat types. And so you can imagine, as you go up the different levels of elevation, you get very different habitats. But the iconic part of the Sonoran Desert is mediated by the fact it has two rainy seasons, one right now and one as a monsoon in July and August. And so we have two different breeding seasons, two different seasons for wildlife to really take advantage of this plethora of water that happens during the year. The saguaro cactus flowers in April and May, you can see the top right there, the top left, iconic scenery that you would have seen on David Attenborough's program last night. So we spend our time exploring four of the most interesting sky islands southeast of Tucson, which is where our house is. And if you can see, there's lots of amazing scenery, such as Cave Creek, which we visit on the right-hand side there. We stay in lots of different types of accommodation, but mainly small inns and lodges that are privately owned by people who we know very well, and fantastic right in the middle of nowhere type of places to give a really good feel for what the Sonoran Desert is like. So I'll quickly whip through some of the species that we might see. Again, birds are one of the highlights. My birds are my passion, and so it's one of the highlights for me is looking for trogons, such as this elegant trogon here on the left, which is one of the most iconic species in Arizona that birders from all over America try and see. And we spend some time looking for those, a beautiful bird. As I said earlier, hummingbirds are a big focus of the tours we do in Arizona, like this stunning male Costa's hummingbird with bright purple iridescent plumes and mustache. They do this amazing display in the spring, in April, which we will be able to see. Now, obviously, in the deserts areas, there's lots of different desert species. One of the most familiar is the cactus wren, the largest wren in the world. They're perched on top of a teddy bear choya that David Attenborough talked about last night, but these are very highly adapted. In fact, you find them breeding in those teddy bear choyas quite regularly. And then one of the features of the birds here is that many of them are found nowhere else in America and are easier to see than where some of them breed in Mexico. And things like the Mexican spotted owl there just get into America in this corner of Arizona, and we look for those on our tours as well. But this is a general wildlife tour discussion, and so there are lots of mammals in the desert. You know, people think the desert doesn't have much going on, but actually it's incredibly biodiverse. Over 2,000 species of plants in the Sonoran Desert alone, and so they provide food for herbivores such as the javelina you can see at the top right there, which we see pretty regularly. At the bottom, the highly desert adapted mammals such as Harris's antelope squirrel, which hardly ever have to drink, and they use their long tail as a sunshade during the day, which is pretty cute. lots of nocturnal activity in Arizona as well, and some amazing nocturnal mammals such as this ringtail, which is like a tree-dwelling mammal relative of the raccoon, but we often look for them up in the trees, scampering around, but they also come to hummingbird feeders and cheat a little bit. So that's pretty cool as well. And there are predators with all these rodents and animals around. There are predators, coyotes and bobcats. Actually, in my view, Arizona is one of the best states in America to see bobcats. This guy has actually just finished drinking out of our water bowl at our house when I snapped this picture out of our kitchen window. So they're around and you can never guarantee, but it's one of the best places we've found to see bobcats. Like California, Arizona is home to hundreds of species of butterfly, over 250 species of butterfly in the Sonoran Desert alone. Again, I had to put my hair streak picture in here. The one on the left is beautiful green and orange hair streak is Arizona hair streak, found at high altitudes. We'll do our best to find those. The beautiful Arizona sister in the top right. These are one of my favorites as well, actually. They glide effortlessly up and down oak-lined canyons up in the Sky Islands. They're just a wonderful butterfly to watch. And then the very interesting looking butterfly on the bottom there is an American snout with a big long proboscis. Very common last year because of the incredible record-breaking monsoons that we had, millions and millions of American snouts flying around in the air at all elevations, all altitudes, covering bushes, and so they're a delight to see. California is home to lots of reptiles, but Arizona is like the kingdom of reptiles. And we do our best to try and find as many as we can, such as the spectacular Gila monster at the top left, the only venomous reptile in America. And interestingly, actually, AstraZeneca markets a diabetes medicine made from one of the components of its venom. On the top right there, we have, yarrow spiny lizard, a high altitude lizard. That's pretty common that we see. Rattlesnakes. 13 species of rattlesnakes in Arizona, and we do go out looking for them on the trails and on night drives. This is a black-tailed rattlesnake on the bottom here, quite a docile, lovely rattlesnake that we'll look for. And then also, David Atbra talked about desert tortoise last night. You saw a picture of that. This is a relative of a desert box turtle, a specialist of the Sonoran Desert that we'll look for too. Because of the two rainy seasons, there's lots of amphibians as well, like the goggle-eyed couch's spadefoot toad on the top left, which you might have heard about. It only comes out once a year from its underground burrows to breed in the rain. And the amazing statistic, they can eat enough in one day to let it survive for the rest of the year. So that we'll look for those. Some very range-restricted amphibians like the Chiricahua and leopard frog on the bottom left. And then there's some that we like to search for along streams and banks in some of the canyons in America, like in Arizona, like this canyon tree frog. This is the Halloween slide. I nearly didn't put it in, but you know, when you're in the desert, you have to look for small things as well. And these are fascinating and amazing creatures to look for, such as the desert hairy scorpion on the left there, that's up against our house wall. Amazingly, in a spotlight night walk that we do, it's about 4 inches long. The least venomous of all the scorpions in Arizona. A beautiful desert blonde tarantula on the bottom. They're pretty common. Very docile, lovely to watch spiders in the desert as they come out at dusk. And then the giant desert centipede, which is about 8 inches long, big centipede, amazing desert specialist that are normally nocturnal. But you can sometimes see those in the day if you're very lucky. And finally, there are some very, very special species that take a lot of work, but sometimes we see them, such as Montezuma quail. Sometimes they're on the side of the road like this guy, but sometimes we just don't find them. Red-faced warbler, sorry, my slides are all over the place. Red-faced warbler, high altitude warbler there that lots of American birders want to see. And a beautiful warbler that happens to be quite close to Tucson. And then the Sonoran Desert toad, again, a specialist of the Sonoran Desert that comes out in the rainy season. So with that, I will close my quick tour around California, Arizona. We'd love to welcome you to come to the Sky Islands and the Sonoran Desert that you can see there in the top left picture. Maybe we'll be lucky enough to see horned lizards, like this regal horned lizard at the bottom right here. on our tours this year. We have two tours left this year with availability. There's one goes in the spring, where we really focus on everything, but with a particular emphasis on reptiles and amphibians, because that's when they're emerging after the winter. There's a good chance to see them. And then our August tour is full, but we do have some places left on the second spring tour in September. And we'd love to welcome you to Arizona or California this year. So with that, I'll stop right there.
Thank you very much, Adam. And thanks to Matthew before you. We've got about 5 minutes, folks, until we kick off again. So feel free to go and grab a drink, something to eat, whatever you need to do. We're back at 25 past eight. Oh, we've got 4 minutes now. Quick break this evening and then we'll be back. Have we got Jane back telling Adam off for going a little bit over and eating into her time?
I'm here, Kerry.
Right, we can't see you again, Jane.
Oh, okay. I'll stop.
Oh, there you are. Yep, you're back. Great. Right. So over to you, Jane. Take us to Texas and the Dakotas.
Excited for this one. Okay. Can you see my screen?
Can you see your screen? And your full screen? Perfect. Excellent. Over to you.
Okay, well, good evening, everybody. My name's Jane Dixon. I'm presenting to you from Fangfoss in East Riding, which is New York. You've just met Adam, and together we actually split our time between the UK and the US, which is where we run our tours for Naturetrek. And we've been doing this since 2019. When not on tour, I'm actually a scientific writer in the pharmaceutical industry. So this evening, I'd love to take you to Southern Texas and show you some of the Southern hospitality down there. So that being said, I wanted to start out with a couple of pictures and images of some of the places that we stay on our Southern Texas trip. So the first is the Lighthouse Hotel, which is overlooking Aransas National Wildlife Refuge, which is just close to the Gulf of Mexico. And we stay there for a few nights on this beautiful Gulf view scene. And from there, we actually explore Aransas National Wildlife Refuge, where we look for whooping cranes, which I'll talk more about later. And then over on the right-hand side, we have the Nolly Farm Ranch. This used to be a dairy ranch, but nowadays it is more attuned to hosting weddings and wildlife groups, actually. And it's a beautiful setting, and it's in the heart of the ranch country between San Antonio and the Gulf. And we spend a night or so there. And as you can see, the view is spectacular looking from the ranch over the lake, where we can see sandhill cranes, actually, that Matthew was talking about earlier, and plenty of other wildfowl. And we have access to a lot of the ranch, so we can explore it and find all the wonderful wildlife that there is to see there. So now that you know what the hospitality is like, we will have a look at where we're actually going on this tour. So we start in Austin, which is very far south in Texas, which of course is the red state at the bottom there. So we fly into Austin, and from there we head south, which where we go to the Aransas National Wildlife Refuge. And then we head further south after that to the Rio Grande Valley. And there's a larger map on the right-hand side here showing where we start in South Padre, which is right on the coast. And then we work our way inland via Brownsville, Alamo, McAllen, and we explore all the different nature reserves, of which there are plenty in this area. So we spend about a week or so down in the bottom here, looking at all the different wildlife that we can find in those nature reserves. And then from there, we actually head northwest up to Edwards Plateau. And there we look and explore the hill country, which is rolling hills and oak trees. And it's a different habitat and therefore many different species. And then we end our tour with a day in San Antonio, which is sort of the cultural part of the tour. There's the Alamo, there's the River Walk, there's plenty of history in San Antonio, so it's a beautiful place to visit. And then we fly out of Austin again. So I'm sure you're excited to find out a little bit more about the wildlife that we'll see down in South Texas. So there are a number of birds that we can see, and I noticed that Matthew had already introduced you to some of these species previously. So in South Texas, we could definitely see greater roadrunner, which is up on the top right there. This is quite a fascinating bird. It's an amazing predator, and we've seen them taking small snakes, lizards, small birds, and we even saw one take a rabbit one day. So that was quite amazing. Moving down, we have the plain chachalaca down in the bottom right here. I would say they're not plain. They live in family groups, and they're quite large birds. sort of chicken size or slightly bigger, and they spend a lot of time making raucous noises and foraging in the undergrowth. So you tend to hear them before you see them. Much more diminutive is the beautiful, flashy vermilion flycatcher. So even though it's small, you're not going to miss that beautiful red flash as it flies up from a bush to get its prey. Matthew also mentioned crested caracara here over on the bottom left. And we tend to see them quite commonly in the along the road verges, actually, where they usually scavenge for roadkill. So we can see those down in Texas too. And then again, I think Matthew took all my thunder. We have the scissortail flycatcher. And again, they sit up on the wires in Texas, so you can usually spot them quite easily as they're flycatching. There's plenty more birds. So of course, I just have to give you a flashy selection here. The three at the over at the top and the left, we can see commonly at bird feeding stations. They are quite common. So in the top right, we've got green jay, and they tend to be in family groups when they feed. So they're also quite loud and gregarious. And as you can see, the great Kiskadee making plenty of noise there on the left. And at the bottom, we have the golden-fronted woodpecker. So these are all pretty common, but all gorgeous birds to look out for. Now, somewhat harder to find is the common paraki, which is down there on the right. It is a bird that is similar to a nightjar, but during the day, it roosts on the ground, and it's usually hidden under the bushes. And so it's quite hard to see. As you can tell, it's very camouflaged against the leaf litter there and the branches and twigs. But we have a few sites where we know they are. So we'll pay special attention in those areas to try and find them, because they are a wonderful bird to see. And it's not just birds. There are also plenty of mammals too. I just picked a few here. I think, again, armadillo, nine-banded armadillo, found in Florida. They're also found in southern Texas. They are quite amusing to watch because they spend most of their time with their noses in the ground and searching and digging up ants, termites, and other invertebrates. And again, like the plain chachalacas, you probably hear them before you see them because they're always snuffling around in the undergrowth. But I find them quite fascinating. Down at the bottom, this is a javelina, collared peccary. It does look like a pig, but they split off from pigs many, many years ago. Adam mentioned that they're also found in Arizona too. The females and the young hang out in family groups, and the boars tend to be solo. And they have they're also called skunk pigs, actually, because they have a scent gland on their rump with which they spread their messages to each other as to where they've been and whose territory's whose. And so it's great to find those. And there's quite a few in southern Texas. And then up in the top left there, we have eastern fox squirrel, which is the largest squirrel, tree squirrel in America. So we'll take a look for those. And some of them are very, very red, actually. This one's quite gray. So we will be looking out for everything. We'll also be heading out on a couple of special trips, the first of which is a boat trip into Aransas National Wildlife Refuge. And we shall be going there particularly to look for the whooping cranes. Once upon a time, back in the sort of early 1900s, there were probably less than 20 whooping cranes left. Nowadays, there are well over 500 individuals living in North America. So that was a successful turnaround of this species. They spend their summers in the north breeding, and then they come down to the south in Texas and Florida, actually, for the winter. But there are a couple of resident families actually in Aransas National Wildlife Refuge. So we'll be heading out early in the morning on the boat, as you can see, and we'll be looking for those. And there's plenty of other wildfowl, water birds to see on the boat trip, and also bottlenose dolphins. And the other special trip we'll be doing is, while we're in the hill country, we'll be visiting a bat cave. So the Mexican free-tailed bats spend their winters down in Mexico, but then they come back north from spring till autumn. And there are hundreds and thousands of them living in this particular bat cave. And so we'll be there in the evening to watch them fly out. And apparently it is an amazing spectacle. Hundreds and hundreds of thousands of Mexican free-tailed bats. Now, also in southern Texas, we have plenty of butterflies. It is a fantastic place to go if you're really interested in butterflies. We have the National Butterfly Center, which is down near McAllen, which we'll be spending probably a couple of mornings in exploring their gardens. And the great thing about Southern Texas is there are lots and lots of different butterfly gardens as well, not just the Butterfly Center. So we get plenty of opportunity to look for some of the specialty species and the residents, of course. And some of the beautiful, I think personally, some of my favorites here are Mexican blue wing, guava skipper, and red bordered pixie. And there's plenty more than that. There are hundreds, so, and you get lots and lots of specialties coming up from Mexico. And of course, we can't go down there without seeing reptiles and amphibians, the first of which is the Rio Grande leopard frog, which we see occasionally, but it's a wonderful frog to see. There's the other frogs as well, which are the one in the other corner, the right-hand corner. It's the green tree frog. Now we have to make a special effort to look for these because they're nocturnal and they're usually found on the windows and walls of buildings. So we'll take a special look at a couple of places where we stay. And then the reptiles, we've got the alligator up in the top right there. And of course, Texas horned lizard, which are amongst my favorite of the lizards. And then we can't really go without looking for some of the specialty bird species in the area. So while we're in the hill country, we'll be looking for the black-capped vireo, which is at the top left, and also the golden-cheeked warbler. We have a couple of wonderful sites for these two birds, but we'll have to make a special effort and walk through the woods and the hills to find them. And then over on the right, a little bit more widely distributed around southern Texas, are the Altamara oriole on the top right, and then the buff-bellied hummingbird. They're not as common as some of the previous birds that I mentioned, so we do have to look for them, and they are very special when you see them. So here we have our eastern screech owl, who actually is a resident at the National Butterfly Center. So he is hopefully going to welcome you to one of our upcoming tours to Texas. And the next one is actually the 25th of March to the 7th of April, 2023. So we look forward to welcoming you to Southern Texas and Southern hospitality. So moving on, again, like Adam, I have to do a whistle tops tour in 20 minutes. So we're now jumping from Southern Texas to the far north, actually, of America. We are heading to the Dakotas. Now, the Dakotas aren't probably states that you would think of visiting. Even some Americans would go, why are you going to the Dakotas? But North Dakota and South Dakota are beautiful states. The habitat is fantastic. The wildlife is outstanding. And entwined with all this wonderful, lovely environment are the icons and legends of this area. So names that you might have heard of, like Sacagawea, Lewis and Clark, Wild Bill Hickok, Jane Cannery, Crazy Horse, and General Custer. So these are totally involved in all of this trip, as well as the wildlife. So let me show you for a start where the Dakotas are. So the yellow block at the top of the United States map are the Northern Plains. And North Dakota and South Dakota are the two states on the right hand of that yellow block. So I've zoomed in now in the lower right here, and you can see there's the Missouri River and South Dakota, North Dakota. So this trip is actually a one-way trip, starting in Rapid City in South Dakota. And then we head north via the Badlands and the Black Hills. And we have a short stint into Wyoming. Then we turn north again, and we head up through the Little Missouri grasslands in North Dakota, through Theodore Roosevelt National Park, and then heading into the Pot Country, which is north of the Missouri River, before we head back to Bismarck, where the tour ends and everyone flies home. So there's a lot of change in habitat throughout this tour, which is why there is such a variety of wildlife to see. So I'd like to introduce you now to some of the species of this area. And as I mentioned, because of the different habitats, we have forests, we have mountains, we have beautiful rivers within those mountains and canyons. And of course, we have the plains. So we have a huge variety of specialized species. The top left, we have Lewis's woodpecker, namesake of obviously Meriwether Lewis, who traveled with Clark on the journey up the Missouri River to find the passage to the Northwest, and they were guided by Sacagawea. In the bottom right, we have the American Dipper, also found in the hills and the mountains and the streams. And then we have the plains species. We have a burrowing owl on the top right there, and I know Matthew mentioned those in Florida, so the burrowing owls get round a bit, and he can see he stood on his hole there. And then also another plain species in the bottom left is Fruginous hawk. And you cannot go to the Dakotas without seeing mammals. I think probably after Alaska, Yellowstone, California, the Dakotas are amongst the best states in which to see mammals in North America. So starting from the top, we've got bighorn sheep, which we can see quite clearly in the Badlands. And then we've got the American red squirrel, which we find in the forests. Back on the plains, we find a bison, and then the mountain goat in the bottom left there. They're usually found in the mountains, particularly around the Black Hills. And then I think this is my favorite squirrel in North America, and it's 13-lined ground squirrel. And that we find obviously in the plains and the grasslands. But there's still more. We have more squirrels, plenty of squirrels to see. So we've got yellow-bellied marmot in the bottom left, black-tailed prairie dogs, obviously found in the prairies, and then least chipmunk in the top right there. And we have some wild mustangs in the bottom left here, and they're found in Theodore Roosevelt National Park. So as I mentioned, there are many, many legends and icons that are entwined into this area. And so we're going to visit some of these cultural sites. First of all, will be Mount Rushmore, which you can see there in the top right. And there's kudos to anyone who can name those four presidents from left to right. Then we also visit the antithesis, I suppose, of Mount Rushmore. This is the statue being built in the mountain to Crazy Horse, who was a Lakota Sioux warrior who fought General Custer over the area that the Lakota Sioux called home, which is the Black Hills. And Custer visited for the gold, of course. So we'll visit there. And then also we'll be taking a trip. This is our short trip into Wyoming to Bear's Teepee, or Devil's Monument. And some may be familiar with this from Close Encounters of the Third Kind, I think. And all of these places are wonderful. They are not only tourist destinations, but they're surrounded by beautiful habitat and lots of wildlife. So we'll certainly be taking a look at what we can find there, and also imbibing some of the history and culture of the area. So I know we're much further north than Florida and Texas and all those warm subtropical states, but we don't have the same number of butterflies and reptiles, but there are a few. So starting on the top left, we have Old World Swallowtail and Milbert's Tortoiseshell. And then in the bottom left, we've got Snowberry Clearwing, which is a moth to be found in that part of the United States. And we've got Greater Shorthorn Lizard here in the bottom right. All of which can be found in this area, and we'll certainly take a look for them. So I don't want to go any further without mentioning some of the wonderful places we're going to be staying on this tour. As I've mentioned, we're staying in the forests and the hills, the mountains, and the ranch land, which are on the plains. So we are going to be staying in a variety of lodges, and also Logging Camp Ranch, which is in the heart of the Little Missouri National Grasslands. This again is a ranch that is still a working ranch, but they also cater for wildlife tourists. We'll be staying in this cabin, or it's a huge sort of log cabin house, in the bottom left here, and we'll be exploring the ranch for about 2 days. And we could actually see sharp-tailed grouse at the ranch. So some gorgeous, gorgeous, lovely lodges to stay in. And then I'm just going to finish off now with a couple or a few highest plains speciality species. The first of which is pronghorn in the top left. And this is the only antelope in the North Americas. And it's also the fastest antelope in the world. However, strangely enough, it can't actually jump. So it would be unable to actually clear that barbed wire fence that you can see behind it. It has to sort of scramble through. So it's quite amusing when you have to see them struggle their way through a fence, but they can do it. So we'll certainly be taking a look for those. This one was a lone male, whereas you normally see them in small herds. And there's also on the right here, we have a chestnut collared longspur, which is a type of bunting, also found in the high plains. So we'll be taking a look for those. And in the bottom, two other plain species are upland sandpiper and long-billed curlew. So as you can see, there are plenty to see in the Dakotas, plus all the wonderful landscapes and scenery and culture. So here I have a couple of slides of the scenery. The left-hand side is the Badlands of South Dakota, and then up on the right there is the Black Hills of the Dakotas, which is where Spearfish Canyon lodges, where we'll be staying. So the upcoming tours to the Dakotas, if you're interested, this year we have one leaving on the 21st of May till the 4th of June. And then we have a second one in 2023, which are the similar dates, 20th of May till the 3rd of June. So we hope to welcome you either to the Dakotas or Southern Texas. And I'm now going to hand over to Brian.
Okay. So I'm just... Evening, everybody. My name is Brian Small, and I'm here this evening to talk to you about two tours, both of them to Cape May in the eastern US. Sorry, I'm just going to go back to the beginning here. Sorry about that. There we go. We do two tours to Cape May, one in the spring and one in the autumn. Obviously, they are by and large bird orientated tours. Unlike the other tours that you've seen this evening, the range of mammals and reptiles is very limited. There's certainly some butterflies, but more or less we concentrate on looking at birds. So my first slide shows where Cape May is. At the top, you can see New York and then Philadelphia. And if you follow all the way down to the bottom of the image, you can see Cape May, which is on a promontory between the Atlantic and Delaware Bay. You can fly in to Newark, or you can fly in to Philadelphia. From Newark, you follow the Garden State Parkway down to Cape May. And from Philadelphia, you cross the Whitman Bridge and then come down through the vinelands and woodland to Cape May. And we don't travel around a lot. It's a single center tour. So if you come down, the Cape May is at the very bottom of the promontory here, and it's a relatively small area. So you're talking about a 2.5 mile square area of land, which is where we tend to spend most of our week. The hotel is a traditional seafront hotel. If you imagine, if you've ever been in the UK and you've been to Southwold, which is where I live, which is a Victorian seaside town, Cape May has an atmosphere which is pretty much the same as that. It's a bit bigger though. Your hotel, the Seacrest, is right next to the beach, and you look out over into the Atlantic and south across towards Delaware to its south. It's a very simple hotel. The rooms have large beds and catering facilities, fridges and so on. And you'll spend 9 nights in the hotel And we tend to then go out on day trips from the hotel. So I'm going to talk first of all about spring. And both of the tours, spring and autumn, are timed for the optimum migration of various groups of species. Spring, largely warblers and shorebirds. And as you can see on this picture, we get large pans of, these are American Dunlin, which are the very black-bellied and rufous-backed birds, mixed in with handfuls of short-billed dowitchers. Most people come to Cape May for the passerine or near passerine perching birds. And although Cape May is at the same latitude as Madrid, the spring is quite late. And so even though we're there in mid-May, the leaves are just coming through. So it's quite a citrus green background here to a yellow-billed cuckoo. And one of the joys is that you do tend to get really excellent views of the birds. These are all my own photographs, which I've taken just as I'm leaning, just pick my camera up, take a few pictures. So looking at the warblers and perching birds, you've got yellow-billed cuckoo. And then into the spring warblers, American wood warblers are particularly beautiful and finely coloured. An American redstart, very black backed, brilliant fiery orange flashes on its flanks and wings and the sides of its tail, which it tends to flick up and down and flashing the orange. You've got a bay-breasted warbler, a male, again with its rufous bay cap, chest. Females are very much duller than that. They're much more brightly yellow-green above. And they've come and feed in the trees. This is actually taken at the Cape May Bird Observatory. A black poll warbler, looking a little bit like a black and white warbler. Again, a male here with its lovely black cap, black and almost humbug streaked back, and a bit of yellow in the wings and bright yellow legs. And we spend quite a bit of our time just walking slowly around some of the areas in the town, looking for warblers and raptors going over. So I'm just, the first slides show the warblers primarily. One of the most difficult one, I'm sorry, this isn't the best of photographs, is a Canada warbler. One of my favorite of all, with its lovely necklace of spots, its eye ring. Quite a difficult bird, slightly secretive compared to some of the other warblers, hence the poor quality of the photograph. In the spring, as well as the leaves coming out in the trees, you've got the beech plum along the beach, which is in flower. And here you've got a magnolia warbler. You can see the white spots in the tail. This is a female, grey above with a flashy, bright citrus, yellow flanks, black streaked. And again, they just seem to be so numerous that they come out and see you. You can call them out, just making a noise. The egg yolk bird, the prothonotary warbler. The prothonotaries were clerics of the Pope, and they used to wear bright yellow clothing. And so prothonotary warbler is named because of the bright yellow colour, like the clerics. And they're quite a difficult bird to see. We got two lot spots for them, one of them very close to the hotel, one where we drive inland to a patch of woodland in Belle Plaine Forest. Again, it's a fantastic bird to see. You've already seen this. This was shown in Florida. So this is the yellow-throated warbler, which you can see either around the town itself or again at Belle Plaine, another beautiful warbler. You get to see perhaps up to 25 species of warbler in spring and in autumn. And there are two stars which we always like to see, the really flashy Blackburnian warbler. This is taken along a little tiny boardwalk near to the lighthouse. And just looking through them, the birds are flitting around in small flocks. And suddenly you catch a glimpse in the leaves of this fiery orange throat. And you then just wait and out comes this amazing bird, and you just watch it in the oak trees catching insects or picking caterpillars off of the tree. So that's especially nice to see. And then Cape May warbler. Cape May warbler again, named because the first specimen was collected at Cape May. Beautiful tiger-striped chest, rufous cheek patch, black cap. And again, really flashy. We try to make sure that we see these, and sometimes they can show especially well. Most of the warblers we've just seen are moving north and they're not breeding in the area. They're moving through to the Canadian taiga, the vast expanse of coniferous forest up in the north. So we're picking up these as migrants, not the yellow-throated warbler, but certainly Cape May is on its way north. As well as spending our time around Cape May, up along the coast of Delaware Bay, up in the north, you've got Hyslerville, and you've also got one or two beaches along the coast there, the shore. And then there are other places, Stone Harbour. And we spend time looking for shorebirds. And the timing of the tour is such that we're waiting really for the horseshoe crabs. The horseshoe crabs come and spawn in Delaware Bay, and all of the eggs wash ashore. You may have seen some early films of David Attenborough walking along a beach with red knot and semi-palmated sandpipers running ahead of him. And those will have been filmed on the beaches here. And so up at Hyslerville, you've got these large pans, which I've already shown you this slide. You get big pans, which when the tide is in, all the birds come in and they roost. They look a lot, but compared to the semi-palmated sandpipers, this is just a small group. The semi-palmated sandpipers come in and sing a lovely trilling song, and you just watch them, and they're just so amazingly tame, and you get very close. You get flocks of black skimmers, you've got the Forster's terns. Again, here you've got short-billed dowitchers and the dunlin. And you just wander around, there are killdeer nesting, you've got bald eagles flying over, peregrines sweep in and flush the birds up. Nothing creates panic like a peregrine. On the beaches, you get boat-tailed grackles. It's very, very noisy. The laughing gulls that you can see in the background make so much noise as the eggs get washed ashore. And there are hundreds and thousands of birds feeding along the beach, and you just stand around and watch them and pick through them, looking out into the bay, perhaps for great northern divers. The red knot, this is a mixture in here. You can see some black-chested turnstones, you can see some red-chested knot, and then some smaller waders, which are the semi-palmated sandpipers. And although this is a fantastic scene, there is no doubt that the birds are in decline, partly because of the usual climate change pressures, but also that the horseshoe crabs are being harvested to make things like crab meat and cat food. But there's a lot of legislation going on to try to restrict that. So hopefully at some stage in the near future, their numbers might start to increase. And like the warblers, these are all on their way north. They time their migration so that they arrive in Delaware Bay just as the horseshoe crabs are spawning, where they fatten up, they increase their body weight, almost double their body weight, so that they can continue north into Canada, into breeding grounds north of the taiga onto the tundra. And there's a picture of the rather prehistoric horseshoe crab on the beach. This is actually at Stone Harbour, but they just come ashore, they get washed ashore after they spawn, and quite a number of them sadly die after spawning. Into the woodlands, I showed you where Belle Plaine Forest was. We go into Belle Plaine because partly for a change of scenery, it's a large forest managed area, but there are certain species that you get breeding there. You get Acadian flycatcher. This is an oven bird, which is almost pipit-like, slightly olive brown back, heavy, strong black streaks. But what you can only just see a glimpse of there is the orange crown stripe, and they creep around on the ground, or they sit in trees and sing. So Acadian flycatcher, sometimes Louisiana water thrush. We'll try for hooded warbler, yellow-throated warbler, prothonotary warbler, and there'll also be spotted towhees and so on. And as well as the birds, there's black swallowtail. Not as many butterflies as you would get in Arizona or Texas, but a fair range, just an introduction to the families. So you get a flashy black swallowtail and a not quite so flashy Horace's dual wing. Back to where to the landscaper here. So the hotel is at the very bottom of the map, and close by, within a mile and a half, you've got the meadows and you get Cape May Point State Park. And the state park is famous for various places, woodland areas and so on. And so a lot of people sometimes say, well, I'll come out, and they want to go back to the hotel for the afternoon. And so having found somewhere for lunch, after lunch, I've often run people back where they can have a walk through the town, and they walk on the beach or just take time out. It's a very relaxing holiday, but there's always plenty to see. And just on the beach in front of the hotel, you can get American oyster catchers. They come and feed, despite the fact that lots of people walk along the beach. There are always things to see on the beach. If it's not an oyster catcher, there'll be sanderling. You get purple martins coming. They have in the state park, at the car park itself near the lighthouse, they've got hanging nesting gourds for the purple martins to nest in, and they sit around early morning on the roofs catching the sun. Quite a large martin, and they're all making this call and flying about. You've got the red-winged blackbird sitting in the tops of the bushes calling. Ruby-throated hummingbird, again another very, very tiny bird, which zap and it's gone, and sometimes they'll sit preening early in the morning and you get a chance to look at them. Just a glimpse of the ruby throat coming in as they turn their head and the light catches the iridescence of that, what looks like black throat, actually sparkles red. Tree swallows, nest boxes are put up for tree swallows. This is a male sat on its box, and they become incredibly tame. And this is again just by the side of the car park at the state park. In the meadows, you get areas of wetland and shallow water for stilt sandpipers, beautiful breeding bird, again on its way north. And on the beach, up at Stone Harbour especially, sometimes they breed at Cape May, but more in the north now, going up towards Atlantic City. Beautiful little tiny, almost teddy bear-like bird with, they run around with their black and orange beaks and orange legs. And again, the bird, which due to the human pressure on the beaches, is in decline, and Stone Harbour is a particularly nice place to see them, both because it's a nice place to have a walk, but also they show really nicely to the crowds. A veery, it is an American thrush, one of the small American Catharus thrushes. Sort of again, a nice orange brown above with soft markings on its underparts. They don't often show quite as well as this, so quite a secretive bird. And we like to look around, we walk through the meadows and through the woodlands looking for these. And finally, Cape May being what it is a migration watch point, you get occasionally rarer birds coming north. This is a Mississippi kite, which circled over the Hawk Watch platform. And one day with a group, I had a message from a friend of mine saying that someone had just reported a magnificent frigate bird. So we're just driving around the lake in Cape May, and I looked up and there it was flying over us. And so we all got out and watched it, and then spend the next hour touring around the town before it eventually flew out to sea and wasn't seen again. So Cape May in spring, you tend to look for shorebirds and warblers. Cape May in autumn, you've got a slightly different range of species. You get the warblers coming south, you get the waders coming south, but also you get a lot of hawks, raptors, coming south. This is the beach at the very tip of Cape May. You can see the lighthouse in the distance. This is the beach right in front of the hotel. So you cross the road, quite a quiet road, and on the beach in autumn, you get a collection of black skimmers. They don't gather there in the spring. So in the autumn, you get black skimmers, you get Forster's terns, you'll get ring billed gulls, you get royal terns, and they come and sit in the group. And again, just being America, birds just seem to be so tame. It's a bird photographer's delight. And again, here you can see what we're all looking at. You can see the black skimmers, you can see the Forster's terns in the back. You've got an out of focus royal tern. And again, just they just pose for the cameras. And here they are in flight. There's a youngster here, which is, they're just weird, almost prehistoric looking birds with their beaks. And you can see them coming in and they skim low through the waves, actually in the sea with their lower mandible, which is longer than the upper mandible. And as they touch a fish, it snaps shut and they catch the fish in that way. An amazing thing to see when they come in groups and feed in the flat, calm shallows. And there's an adult, molting adult, and a young royal tern. Again, so one of the other things about Cape May in the autumn is we tend to go to a famous place called Higbee's, and they have what's called the morning flight project there, where the birds which are migrating south suddenly change their mind, and rather than migrate south, they come in and they move north and they go up round Delaware Bay. So you've got Higbee's here, but you also get the Hawk Watch platform near the lighthouse, and the Hawk Watch platform looks over Bunker Pond. And many's the hour that the group has spent 2 or 3 hours just sat on there. There's counts going on since the early 1970s. They've had an organized raptor count, Hawk Watch count, where they count for 2 months every autumn. They'll count the birds of prey and other species that are moving south. And we can join them. There are volunteers there helping everybody. And you look out over Bunker Pond and you'll get large numbers of raptors. The most common would be sharp-shinned hawks, Cooper's hawks, merlin, American kestrel, big numbers of things like turkey vulture, black vulture, bald eagle. It's a pretty spectacular place. I've seen, in 3 hours, I've seen something like 1,500 sharp-shinned hawks go over, maybe 500 American kestrels and move south in the day. And what they're hunting dragonflies and small birds and the other migrants which are coming through. Merlins are particularly like things like blue jays and northern flickers which are coming through. And we just stand there soaking it all in, watching the birds move. And the pictures I'm about to show you have all been taken from the Hawk Watch platform. So you've got American kestrel, superb little bird with translucent spots in its wing, beautiful lead gray and raw sienna color on its back. A peregrine on its way from the tundra heading south. They're they sit in there. This is one which was sat on a pylon. The whole group got out, walked up to the bottom of the pylon and looked up at it. Just simply incredible. A young bald eagle come up over the Hawk Watch platform. And there are so many things to see. There'll be Cooper's hawk passing through and sharp-shinned. Sometimes don't really know what to look at. A Cooper's hawk. Cooper's hawk is halfway in size, perhaps, between a sharp-shinned and a goshawk. It's bigger than our sparrowhawk in Europe. It's got this is a youngster, so you can see the streaking on the underparts. But one of the distinct parts about it is it's got a rounded tail compared to a square cut tail. With sharp shins have very rapid wing beats. These are slightly slower wing beat, but they have that shape to them. Ospreys. So in Chesapeake Bay and Delaware Bay, there are perhaps 1,500 pairs of osprey, and even more going up the coast between Cape May and New York. And you get large numbers of them come in, and they fish in the pond. They'll grab a fish, and then they go and sit on, again, telegraph poles in the town, where you can drive along, you suddenly see one with a fish and you get out and they just look right at you as you're looking up at them from the Hawk Watch platform. And then in the autumn, you can get unusual species. For anyone who's been to Texas and further south, a Swainson's hawk isn't necessarily all that unusual, but up in the northeast of the US, it is. And this is a youngster, this is a young Swainson's hawk. So moving away from the Hawkwatch platform, the salt marshes and salt grass are in the autumn filled with herons. You've got great egrets, you've got snowy egrets here. You'll get, again, boat-tailed grackles again in small parties, all sitting around looking at the sky and displaying to each other, even in the autumn. You get the shorebirds, you get ibis. This is an American avocet. Again, a very fine bird. This was taken up at Brigantine, which is a large area of a wetland, a wildlife refuge, north of Atlantic City, about 40 miles. It's about the furthest that we drive from the town. So we'll have a day out, drive, gather, get some lunch from a local deli, and then we'll drive up there for a day. And we drive around these large pans where they're filled again with waders, and there'll be ibis and herons, and there'll be sparrows, get buzzed by peregrines, northern harriers come through. Again, in autumn, piping plover, not quite as brightly coloured, but just a few hang around before they migrate further south for the autumn. We usually manage to get a few at the end of September and beginning of October. If you want to hone your wader skills, it's a particularly good place for identifying waders. Is a juvenile semi-palmated sandpipers with its scaly anchor-shaped marks on its back, a short bill, and then compare that with a western sandpiper. Western sandpipers are usually, this is a youngster as well, but it's already molted some of its mantle feathers here. These are already new, no longer juvenile. It's got a longer bill, a slightly different way of feeding. In the reeds of the state park, you're going to get bobolink. They come in and feed, brightly coloured, and then you can hear them sometimes they just get flocks of them heading over, and they've got this link call, which you know that they're around. Swamp sparrow is probably not a good example of a sparrow, because you'll see a lot more of other common things like savannah sparrow, song sparrows, and so on, are much more numerous. But again, this is one nice to see if you can find one as it skulks around in the reed bed. An autumn Cape May warbler, lovely autumn colours of the trees. You've got the tiger stripe. This is a male in the autumn. Females are not quite so strongly coloured, but you can still see the tiger stripes. And they've got this plain, creamy white, off-white bar on their median coverts, which we tend to look for. This again is taken right on the edge of the bird observatory, where we walk slowly around, usually not just us, but other groups of bird watchers. There are two festivals, the Cape Migration in May. There's also an autumn migration festival. And there are lots of people around to talk to you about birds and just share their experiences. And it's such an amazing atmosphere, very friendly. Black and white warbler behaving like a nuthatch. Northern Perula, again, beautiful colour, not as brightly coloured as spring birds may be, but again, still beautiful. And again, these are one of the more numerous of the migrating warblers. And you get palm warblers. This is a western palm warbler. A lot of the eastern palm warblers, like this, which are more brightly coloured, go and leave early. We just get the trailing few eastern palm warblers, but most of them are drabber, almost looking a bit like a chiffchaff, and behaving like a chiffchaff too. Again, showing well, this is just right by the edge of the car park where we'll wander around. And then just occasionally other things, we'll find a nighthawk perched in a tree, just roosting on its way south. Northern flickers, we get flocks of northern flickers and blue jays calling early in the morning, sweeping around, pursued by merlins sometimes and sharp-shinned hawks. And they just sit out, amazing, amazing views. This is a view actually from the Hawkwatch platform where there's a little patch of trees. And then we wouldn't be Cape May without talking about the monarch. Monarchs' numbers fluctuate this far north. Sometimes there'll be hundreds, sometimes thousands, sometimes tens of thousands. And in the early morning, they'll come in, sit in the bushes, feeding in the flowers, ready before they'll suddenly just all fly up and head off south. There'll be others. This is an American lady, similar to our Painted Lady, which also occurs there. You've got a Halloween pennant. You get dragonflies that are quite numerous in the autumn. A lot of the American kestrels and merlins chase them around and catch them on the wing. And this is a Carolina saddlebag, looking a little bit worse for wear. You get black saddlebags, you're going to get green darners and so on and so forth. And finally, this is the view, sunset from the hotel. At the end of the road, you've got the sunset going down towards Cape May Lighthouse. And I have two tours. There's the first one, which I've not done for Naturetrek yet, which is this spring, 9th to the 18th of May. And then in autumn, the 25th of September to the 4th of October. And I would certainly love to see you there.
Brilliant. Thank you, Brian. Thank you to Jamie for you. Right, well, welcome Adam and Jane and Matthew back if they're all there. And we'll answer some questions. So, hello, Jane, Adam, right? Yeah, I'm Matthew back. We're all back. I'm going to quickly answer the first question from Connor, which was how are things looking for travel to America? I am very much assuming that is a COVID related question. And I'm thinking it's all looking pretty good, guys. Matthew's off there in a week or so. Adam and Jane, you're going back shortly. Brian's off in May.
I'm actually off to New Mexico. I'm going to New Mexico in 2 weeks' time, guiding.
Right. Everyone's going there imminently. So I guess you've all had to book a test before you go. Make sure you're vaccinated. And I think that's probably about it.
Yep.
Yeah, they won't let you in unless you're vaccinated. Yeah. And you have to have a negative PCR a day before you travel.
Yeah, yeah. And we can tell you where to get those, or you can do it at the airport if you're staying overnight. We're all old hat at this now, so.
they do drive-through PCRs at Heathrow now.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. And I think Gatwick's the same, I think most airports are the same now, there's lots of providers. So if you've got an early morning flight and you're staying over the night before, then that's quite an easy way of ticking off that requirement. We're feeling pretty good about things with America this year, and yeah, fingers crossed we'll get lots of tours there and lots of you overseas there. An interesting question for Adam. So Andrew asks, Adam mentioned the Salton Sea is an amazing birding site. There were reports some time ago about competing water interests which threaten the existence of the sea. Any comments?
Yeah, this is a great question and one I could talk a lot about, so I'll try not to. But yes, the Salton Sea is relatively recent man-made lake. The Colorado River was dammed at the late 1800s, and in 1905 the dam broke and water flooded out from the Colorado River for weeks, and it created this really, really long, 40 mile long lake, 20 mile wide, that's been there for 100 years or so. And over that time, there hasn't really been much additional inflow. There's been lots of evaporation, so the habitat has changed subtly over the years. And very recently now, as Andrew mentioned, the extraction rate has got very large because of farming and cement production and things like that. And so as you walk around the Salton Sea, actually you can see markers where the water used to be, and it can actually be a bit disturbing. So 5 years ago, the Audubon Society of California started this program to try and educate farmers and educate industry not to use so much water. And it's starting to pay dividends in a couple of ways. One is that the water level is not declining as fast. It's still declining, but it's not as fast. But secondly, because it's such a dynamic environment, there are new habitats now being created in areas that they weren't before. So, for example, there's a lot more wetlands now than there used to be. And so while you still get lots of cormorants and pelicans and fish-eating birds, you get many, many more migratory waders and mud feeding birds now because of the wetlands, and rails, Ridgeway's rails are now coming back at the Salton Sea when they never used to be there. So it's a dynamic environment. Water level will continue to change for decades to come, and probably eventually it will evaporate away, but that would have happened naturally anyway. So it's a great place to visit time and time again because you do see it. And I first went there 20 years ago, and now I can definitely tell a difference in the types of birds that you see.
Great question and great answer. Thank you, Adam. Okay, one for Brian. Kate says that Cape May, how dependent on weather are the number of migrants? Can you draw a blank if the weather is unfavourable?
In spring, not really in spring. Spring, the birds are trickling through because when they're moving through in spring, birds tend not to focus just on the coast. So they're moving north in a wide band through sort of central eastern part of US going up into the tiger forests. And so you're getting, you don't get the large numbers that you get in autumn, but there'll always be numbers of them there. Sometimes 10, 20, but that's more to do with their movements than the weather. The spring weather tends to be quite balmy, sunny, mid-20s centigrade. In the autumn, again, there'll always be birds migrating south, but if you get these cold fronts coming out from Canada, from the northwest, pushing out towards the coast, what they do is they push the warblers. They have radar, and you can see these massive radar where they can see the warblers and migrants going out, and they go out to sea, and some of them continue, but some of them almost as if they panic, and then they turn back into the coast, and then they hit the land. And so early morning, you're getting flocks. When the weather's like that, you're getting groups of flocks of warblers flying over your heads, all chipping and zipping and zitting. But during the day, they settle down. So for a really big fall, is weather dependent. And we're constantly looking at the weather and hoping that we're getting this. But even if we don't, we're going to get a chance. Sometimes there are so many birds that it's you just sit back and just take it all in and then slowly pick through them. But when there are fewer birds, you have more time to go through them. But there are always things to see. You'll never have a blank, but you might not have one of the really big days. That sort of happens maybe two or three times every autumn. You just have to happen to be lucky. You can get that. Usually we get one day when there are large numbers of warblers moving.
Thank you, Brian. And whilst we've got you, Steve in the chat says Cape May cetaceans. Is there any opportunities there?
There are cetacean trips. We don't go out. We tend to spend most of our time looking out to sea for bottlenose dolphins, which we always see the just off Cape May. They get what's called the rips, which is a mixture of the water coming out from Delaware and the Atlantic, and it's a very fertile area of breeding for fish, and so you'll see it's always covered with gulls and terns, and then the bottlenose dolphin, but we don't go out looking for cetaceans.
Okay, and the grilling of Brian's going to continue with another one that just popped in. Andrew asks, when does the migration start in the autumn? Is it pretty consistent over the month of September?
Yeah, so birds move at different times. So if you want to see some of the really difficult species like Connecticut warbler and hooded warbler, they've gone by the end of September. You might be lucky and see a Connecticut warbler. You might find some people are trying to string along a yellow throat as a Connecticut warbler, but the big migration is going to start around about the 20th, bit earlier, 15th onwards, and that then goes through. In actual fact, there's really large numbers of warblers, which are myrtle yellow rump warblers. They're coming through in the first week of October, and you can get hundreds of thousands of those moving through in a year in the autumn. But they're really big numbers, but the big variety is at the end of September, beginning of October.
Ideally, we want to run a month-long tour, don't we? Then we can take off all of that time period and get those three solid days you mentioned.
You'd enjoy a month at the Cape May, definitely.
Yeah, sounds good. No more questions coming in. I'm just going to quickly pick up one that we answered in the chat, Matthew answered, about meals being included or not, because this is a slight quirk of many of our US tours compared with pretty much all of the Nature Trek trips where all your meals are included throughout. Quite a lot, if not all of our US trips, we don't tend to include meals other than breakfast. We've dabbled with this, haven't we, Jane Adam, over the last couple of years, whether to include or not. And we've settled on not including lunches and dinners for most of these tours, just because you get a lot of food. And it's quite hard to get through if you're on a week-long, 10-day, two-week-long tour. And people don't want three courses for lunch, three courses for dinner, massive portions every meal. and you end up paying for food that you're just going to throw away, and it's a complete waste. So we tend to not include lunches and dinners. It gives you the opportunity to decide what you want to eat, how much eat at each meal. We still, as Matthew says in his question, we still organise the meals for you. There's no pressure for you to go out and roam Cape May or anywhere to find your own food. We'll still have a group dinner, and we'll organise that as an evening. And then during the day, we can quite often pick things up from a shop on our way and bits and bobs like that. It works nicely. I know it's a bit different from most nature trek tours, but it does seem to work out there quite well, nicely. That seems to be it. No more questions. No, I think we're all about done there. So I'm going to say thank you once again to Brian, to Jane, to Adam, to Matthew. I thoroughly enjoyed all of your talks this evening. I'm keen to get myself back out to the States along with the rest of the world, but I would love to join any of you on any of your tours. Take me to Florida next week, please, Matthew. And we hope to see you again soon. I meant to look up what we're doing next and I can't remember. So I can't tell you where to join us next week. I'm sure it's somewhere marvellous. Anyone else got any idea? No. Sorry, I can't plug it tonight, but pop onto the website. We'll be going somewhere next week and I'm sure we're fabulous. So do join us and we'll all see you again soon.
It's 8th of February and it's wildlife cruises.
Of course it is. That's why I'm not hosting. It's back to Sarah, the cruise extraordinaire. She'll be hosting you and taking you to some marvellous places. Brilliant. Thanks, Matthew. Right. Good night, everyone.
Bye.
Bye. Good night.